Assalamu alaikum students. Today we shall begin with the very first unit of our syllabus, that is plants. And the very first chapter is why we need plants. For this you can refer to your textbook page number 84 and 85. The objective of today's class is to know the importance of plants to life on earth. Out of so many important reasons, the first reason that we are going to study is that plants give us biomass. What is this biomass? The material living things are made of is called biomass. And the living thing that we are studying today is plants, right? So you can say biomass is nothing but all the wood in the tree trunk. Also, biomass is made of two things, air and water. Now you might be wondering, how is that possible? Let's go ahead to find the answer. Plants' cells use chemical reactions to build biomass. To do this, they need two small molecules. As you can see on the screen, carbon dioxide and water. So using carbon dioxide and water, the plant cells undergo a reaction in which the resultant is glucose. While this glucose is formed, some oxygen is also being released. So the reaction is carbon dioxide plus water in presence of light. Now, where is this light coming? This light is coming from the sun. So when carbon dioxide and water are going to react, the resultant will be glucose and some oxygen might be released. Now this reaction might look very familiar to you. This reaction is nothing but your reaction of photosynthesis, which you have studied so many times. I hope you remember. So the solar energy enables the plants to build larger molecules such as glucose. So from these two smaller molecules, carbon dioxide and water, a larger molecule is formed, which is glucose. This chemical reaction is of photosynthesis. It is said that it sustains life on earth. Now what do you mean by this? As you can see on the screen, the reaction is also releasing oxygen. And we all know that we need oxygen to live. We breathe in oxygen, right? We cannot survive without oxygen. So that is why it is said that it sustains life on earth. Let's move ahead. Now this glucose molecule is a source of energy. How? This glucose molecule contains stored energy. But the cells can only release the energy from glucose by another process. That process is called respiration. Now actually photosynthesis and respiration are complete reverse of each other. How? Let me tell you. If you are told to write the reaction of respiration instead of photosynthesis, you're going to apply reverse thing over here. So in the reaction for respiration, you're going to write glucose plus oxygen giving you carbon dioxide and water. This glucose molecule will be broken down and energy will be released. So you can say photosynthesis stores energy while respiration releases energy. Always remember, respiration is the reverse of photosynthesis. So over here, when you are beginning the reaction with carbon dioxide and water in photosynthesis, in respiration you are going to begin the reaction with glucose and oxygen, and to the right hand side of the arrow you will get carbon dioxide and water. A plant uses half the glucose it makes to release energy. So whatever photosynthesis took place, a lot of amount of glucose is made now. From all of this glucose, half the glucose is used for respiration and energy is released. So from glucose, half glucose ka respiration happened and carbon dioxide and water is released. So now you might be wondering, what about the other half of the glucose? So the plant uses the rest of the glucose molecules and small amount of minerals for its growth and repair. So to summarize, out of all the glucose molecules made, the plant uses half the glucose for respiration to release energy, and the remaining half glucose is used by the plant for its growth and repair. So these molecules are used, or you can say the molecules which are used for growth add up to the plant's biomass. I hope it is clear to you. Moving ahead, we are going to look at the structure of a leaf in detail. As you can see on the screen, this is a vertical section through a leaf. Now, most of the photosynthesis or the photosynthetic reactions that are taking place in the plant happens, we all know it happens in the leaf. We've been studying it uses chlorophyll, so it happens in the leaf. But where exactly in the leaf? Can you see the layer palisade mesophyll cell? This is the layer where most photosynthetic reactions take place. Number 3, palisade mesophyll cell. So over here photosynthesis is taking place. Because photosynthesis is taking place, obviously this layer is going to have a lot of chloroplast, right? Because in chloroplast there is chlorophyll, so the plant will photosynthesize. So if this is the site for photosynthesis, it obviously is going to be very rich in chloroplast. Another important layer that you are going to study over here is the spongy mesophyll. This spongy mesophyll layer is at the bottom of the leaf. So it makes it easy for gases to circulate. Now which gases? Obviously carbon dioxide and oxygen. Carbon dioxide which the plant is taking inside and oxygen where it is sending it out. So all these gases are being, this layer makes the gases easy to circulate, because as you can see there is lot of air space in this layer, there is lot of space, so it becomes easier for the gases to circulate. Another important part that you're going to study is the stomata. Stomata is nothing but the small pores. Can you see the pore where the arrow is being pointed? It is between two guard cells. So this pore is where the actual gas exchange takes place. From this pore, or you can say from this hole, oxygen is going to exit the leaf and carbon dioxide is going to enter. One more important part of a leaf is the xylem and the veins which are there in the leaf. You might have seen a leaf, right? There are veins present. So the function of the vein is to bring water and minerals from the root and supply it to the leaves. The water and leaves are also travel through one more place which is called as the xylem. We are going to study more about xylem in the next few chapters. So right now, you just need to remember three important things from the diagram. The first one is the palisade mesophyll cell. In this, you are going to remember it is the near the top layer of the leaf. It is the main place or the main site where photosynthesis takes place. And this layer is rich in chloroplast. The second important thing that you're going to remember is the spongy mesophyll layer. What is the function of this layer? This layer has got many air spaces, so it becomes easier for the gases to circulate. Which gases? Oxygen and carbon dioxide. The plant is not going to need oxygen, so the oxygen has to be removed out and carbon dioxide has to be taken in. So where is this actual movement taking place? Through the stomata. Entry and exit is circulation is happening in the spongy mesophyll cell, but it is actually exiting from the stomata. Stomata is nothing but the small pore or the small hole between two guard cells. Also, we saw that the veins carry minerals and water from the roots to the stem, and it is giving it to the leaf, and that supply is done by the xylem. Xylem is nothing but a hollow tube. The details of xylem will be studied in the next few chapters. We're going to move ahead now and see about starch. Now, what is this starch? We all saw that the plant, when it is photosynthesizing, it is making glucose. Sometimes when the cell is not requiring any energy or it is no growth is required, that time that glucose need to be stored, right? So for example, whenever the cell is short of food, so it can use this glucose and it will function. But the problem is that this plant cells cannot store glucose. Small molecules such as glucose can't be stored in the cells. So what is the alternative? Different molecules of glucose, they are joined together to form a long chain. Now imagine one of you, one student in the class is a glucose molecule. That cannot be stored, so they are joined together. So I call many students outside and you're going to hold hands and form a chain. Similarly, many glucose molecules are joined together and we get a starch molecule. So glucose cannot be stored in the plants, so it is converted into starch. Plants need to store some glucose in their cell. Why? Because cells can respire at night. Now, photosynthesis is going to take place only in the morning in the presence of sunlight, right? At night, the plant cannot photosynthesize. So, where will it require, how will it get glucose? For that reason, it has to respire at night also. So, for that reason, glucose has to be stored. But can it store glucose? No. So, this glucose is being converted into a larger giant molecule, which is called as starch. Leaves can store starch for at least 2 to 3 days. Now, this starch is very easy to detect by a test. Now, this test is called as the iodine test. Iodine is nothing but a chemical which you get in the lab. I wish we would have been in school right now, so we would have performed this experiment. But never mind. When we meet, we shall perform this experiment, inshallah. So we take iodine solution. It is a yellowish brown color liquid. Okay. Now, when this iodine solution comes in contact with starch, you might have known potato, rice. These two compounds or these two food molecules are very rich in starch. So for example, I take a potato and I put 2 drops of iodine. I told you the color of iodine is yellowish brown. As soon as this iodine is going to react with starch, there will be a color change. It is going to turn bluish black. So, iodine test detects the presence of starch. So, wherever you have to detect starch in a leaf, you're going to do iodine test. What is going to happen? the iodine solution is going to turn blue black. Let's move ahead to the last part of the chapter, where we're going to study what happens to the oxygen. There is this plant called as pondweed. Pondweed is a plant which is found in ponds and oceans. What does this plant do? Instead of taking carbon dioxide, why is it requiring carbon dioxide first thing? Obviously for photosynthesis. So when it is requiring carbon dioxide for photosynthesis, instead of taking it from the air, pondweed takes it from water. It's a water plant. So instead of taking carbon dioxide from air, it is taking from water. So we can also do this as an experiment. You take a pondweed plant and you see when it is photosynthesizing. We all know when it photosynthesizes, it releases oxygen, right? So if you take water, you put a pondweed plant, it is going to take carbon dioxide from water, it is going to photosynthesize, and it is going to release out oxygen. So how do we understand that it is photosynthesizing? Because when the oxygen is being released into the water, bubbles are being formed. So you can count the number of bubbles. So this is how, or you can say this plant is useful if you want to measure how fast photosynthesis reaction is going. You can count the bubble or measure the volume of oxygen that is produced. Isn't it interesting? Let's have a quick overview of today's class. We first saw the importance of plants is because it gives us biomass. The tree, the wood in the tree trunk is nothing but biomass. Then we saw a reaction, that is carbon dioxide and water giving you oxygen and glucose. This is nothing but the reaction of photosynthesis. And the reverse of photosynthesis is respiration. What happens in respiration? This glucose has been broken down to release energy, but not all glucose is used for respiration. Half is used for respiration, half is used for growth. Then we saw the structure of the leaf. Three important things: the palisade layer, the spongy mesophyll layer, and the stomata. And we also saw what is xylem. It's a hollow tube which carries water. Then we also saw that at night, when the plant has to photosynthesize, the plant has to respire, at night photosynthesis does not take place, so it is going to require glucose. So some glucose needs to be stored, but plants cannot store a small molecule of glucose, so it has been converted to starch. Remember the example of holding hands. All the students holding hand together, forming a long chain, that is nothing but the starch molecule. Then to check the presence of starch, we studied a new test, that is the iodine test. If iodine reacts with starch, the color will change to bluish black. Then we saw a unique plant which is called as the pondweed, which helps you to measure how fast photosynthesis is taking place. How? Because it is going to take carbon dioxide from the water and it is going to release out oxygen, so bubbles will be formed. You count the bubbles or you directly measure the volume of the oxygen produced. So that's all for the day. I hope this session was clear to you, and we shall meet in the next class. Thank you.